So today I'd like to comment on a video put up on YouTube by Darren Brown. He's an English mentalist, hypnotist, illusionist. And in today's episode, he attempts to show that religious belief and religious experience comes from us and not from God. And the way he tries to do this is by producing, artificially stimulating a religious experience in an atheist. And so let's watch, and I will pause from time to time and comment.
Tonight, I'm going to investigate what I think could be the biggest placebo of them all. God. I'm going to use experiments to show how religious experience can be explained by psychology, and then I'll put that theory to the test by using that knowledge to give an atheist an experience of a religious conversion.
Nice to see you, Natalie. Here we come.
When were you last in church?
Some christening or wedding no longer than a couple of years ago, I think, yeah.
When did you last go for devotional reasons?
I've never been for devotional reasons, yeah. More ceremonial.
Yeah, so you're an atheist, are you? I take it by me.
Yeah,
yeah. And you're a stem cell scientist.
Mm-hmm.
How long have you done that for?
Oof, nearly 6-7 years, actually, yeah.
Can you ever imagine being a believer?
For me, that would be literally last resort. You know, there's other things, there's self-belief for my, you know, that would help me get through bad times, you know.
So never have been, can't ever see yourself being a believer?
No.
Didn't. Cool.
So here's the challenge. I'm taking someone who is a staunch atheist and scientist with a skeptical, analytical mind and trying to give her a religious experience in order to show how religious belief comes from us, not from the divine.
Okay, just let me pause right there. So you noticed what he just said. He said that he wants to show if he can produce a religious experience through some sort of psychological manipulation or suggestion, then he believes he will have shown that religious experience and belief comes from us, not from the divine. But there's a bit of a problem here. You can probably maybe see it, and that is this. We have a lot of experiences of things in real life, and some of those things, some of those experiences can be, or the feelings of those experiences can actually be recalled or stimulated in the absence of whatever it was that we had those feelings from in the first place. And so it is true that sometimes, let's say we hear a certain song and it reminds us of the smell of a cedar forest after the rain, we can literally seem to smell those cedars. But it does not logically follow, therefore, that the smell of cedars is a concept that comes from within and not from cedars that are actually in existence and out there. So it's very important to make that distinction here, that it does not logically follow that if you can stimulate an experience using psychological approaches, that therefore the thing they believe that they're experiencing doesn't actually exist out there at all.
And these facts are not the only things working against me. Usually, in the case of a conversion, Natalie would be searching for some sort of answer to life's problems, but she's quite happy with her life, so I won't have that advantage. Neither am I the preacher at a big religious rally, which can easily create a hyper-suggestibility and ensure that large numbers of people convert every night. I want this to be a real...
Yeah, I have to admit quite a degree of reservation about some of the things that go on at large meetings that seem quite clear to me to be a psychological manipulation or a physiological stimulation to feel as if it's the presence of God. Yet, as listening to one person who deconverted from Christianity, he was saying he gets those same feelings, for example, at a Coldplay concert. In other words, it's very important for us to be able to distinguish between what am I being manipulated to experience and what is actually out there, and which experiences are real and which are manipulated. That's an important thing, and Let's keep that in mind as we proceed.
To be a real and profound experience for her, and not just something she thinks I've talked her into. So I'll have to do it indirectly, without mentioning God at all, so she doesn't attribute it to me. And I'll give myself 15 minutes to do it.
So during my 15-minute conversation with Natalie, I'm going to have her create the feeling of being loved by a perfect father, and then I'm going to associate that feeling with a trigger so I can bring it back whenever I want.
What's your relationship like with your dad?
It's brilliant. He is. Without, putting him on a pedestal, he's sort of my hero.
Is he? Yeah. That's such a lovely, lovely thing. There's a lot of people, I guess, don't have that. When you were little, when you were tiny, the same?
But basically, when I was a child, Dad was came home 7 from work. So if he was ever naughty, it'd be like, wait till Dad gets home. He was seen as the more, disciplinarian.
So just as a thought exercise, if you imagine that your dad didn't have to go to work when you were little, that he had nothing to do other than be completely devoted to you, how does that make you feel?
I've now started tapping my fingers on the table whilst talking to Natalie. I'm associating in Natalie's unconscious the emotion she's feeling with that tapping. Then later I can trigger them again by tapping in the same way moments before her religious experience.
How does that make you feel?
Makes me feel special. I'm really honoured and just special. Yeah.
By her trance-like expression, Natalie is showing signs of unconscious processing and is absorbed in the idea of a perfect father figure. And now these feelings are in place, I'll get her to attach them to God later in the process.
What about, have you ever had things in your life, things that went wrong, or, things that didn't work out as they were supposed to, or mistakes that you made?
Relationship, but,
No, that's a fairly standard thing. So at some point there has been a relationship that hasn't worked out brilliantly, of course. But when you look back, are you more able to understand how so why that happened? Is it like a bit of a grand plan?
It allowed me to live the rest of my life the way I wanted it to.
What is that?
I'm getting Natalie to see that the things that have gone wrong could have happened for a reason and were part of a bigger plan. Now she needs to connect that with feelings of being cherished and a sense of awe and wonder.
Is it where do you sort of physically feel it if you think about it? Tell me, does it make
my heart, because the emotion that you feel when you're hugged, it starts off in my chest and my heart, because it's just to feel so safe and protected.
Did you go on holiday a lot when you were little?
Yeah.
One thing we never did, which I always wanted to do, was go up a mountain top and have that feeling of standing at the top. That feeling of absolute awe. What is awe to you then? What is that kind of, is it that, if you think about it?
For me, awe is looking at a full night sky of stars, and to know that each pinpoint isn't just a little speck of light, it's a planet or a sun, to know it's all up there. And
I think actually those are two things that be very rare to get both those feelings together and combined into one.
We've reached a crucial stage in our conversation. After discussing and provoking feelings of both being cherished and a sense of awe, I'm using my hands to physically combine both emotions, and this will help me generate these emotions simultaneously in Natalie during her religious experience.
It'd be very rare to get both those feelings together and combined into one sort of one image of kind of both intense awe and feeling of everything is so much more than me, and I'm tiny, and at the same time, absolutely just being cherished and sort of and held in that.
In a way, that sort of the feeling of being cherished makes it even more special to know that you are insignificant, and yet someone's so still willing to cherish you that much. It's like, well, I must be that bit special.
With over half of my 15 minutes gone, I feel I am close to giving Natalie the experience of a religious conversion.
I have here
that meeting you're seeing with her in the church. Happened a week earlier to this, so he already knows the outcome of that meeting at this show, this TV show that he's doing, and so he can speak with confidence, but he now takes a break to do a little experiment, and let's watch this.
A little bottle of a very powerful peppermint oil. When I open this, it's strong enough that the smell will permeate the room. Obviously, it's going to be fainter for those of you at the back. It'll be fairly faint by the time it reaches all of you. But what I want you to do, as soon as you smell it, is to put your hand up. And the point of this is to see how a scent moves around a room, because it's not quite in the way that you might think it will. So the moment you smell it, it will only be faint. Please put your hand up. Do keep your hands up. Anyone else? Good. Excellent. Thank you very much. You can drop your hands now. Thank you very much. Good. So here's the twist. The smell was not, in fact, generated by the peppermint oil. That is not peppermint oil. That's actually just water. There you go, Connor, if you smell that. Nothing in there, is there? It's just water. You smell anything at all?
Nothing.
No.
Nothing at all.
And that will relax you quite nicely. See me afterwards. The smell was actually generated by a sound wave. If you transmit a sound wave at 18.98 hertz into a contained space, such as we've done with you guys here, there are sort of hidden speakers, black speakers there, there's one there, one over there, and one just there, that are transmitting the sound wave into a contained space. If you do that, it resonates. The sound will resonate with a very small part of the brain responsible for smell, and it gives a lot of people, not everybody of course, but a large number of people, a definite sensation of smelling something sort of fresh and minty. And the fun thing is, this can also be done through the television set. But it's precisely this expectation and suggestion that I'm working with during my attempt to give Natalie her religious experience using purely psychological techniques.
Okay, so I want to say something that's very important for us to understand here. At the beginning, he tells us that if he can stimulate or produce or manipulate a religious experience through purely psychological techniques, he therefore concludes that he demonstrates that religious experience comes from within and not from the divine. Now, what we've just seen here is he has manipulated the crowd, or some of the crowd, into believing they're smelling peppermint when in fact there is no odor of peppermint in the room. I paused the video earlier to see what percentage of the audience, and it's not the majority, I would say maybe 25%, if that, believed they were smelling peppermint. The other three quarters didn't actually smell any peppermint. Now, he claims that the smell was actually generated through some harmonics from some speakers there at a particular frequency. I don't know if that's true or not. Like, when I watch these guys and I'm in a show like that, I don't accept anything that they say, basically. I'm just there for the show, just for the enjoyment. So whether those speakers actually did anything or not, I don't know. But the point is, even if they did, they believed they were smelling peppermint when in fact they were not. Now, here is a very important point. In order for him to deceive or manipulate the audience into believing they were smelling peppermint, they would have already had to have experience of the real thing. If they had no idea what real peppermint smelled like, then, of course, he wouldn't be able to manipulate them into believing they were smelling something they had never experienced. So that's important. And the reason that I mention this is that it does not logically follow that because they were manipulated to believing they were smelling peppermint, therefore peppermint doesn't exist. It does not follow that something does not exist simply because you can stimulate somebody into believing they're experiencing it sometimes, at least a small portion of the audience. Very important now to take that into what happens next with I would call it hypnotism of Natalie, or his suggestion, psychological suggestion of manipulation. So let's continue.
I suppose also you're working with placebos at the moment, aren't you, with the stem cell research, which is an area that really interests me in you. The show before this show that's going up now is actually about placebos. But there were a small number of people that just weren't going to quite embrace it. They were a bit more skeptical about it. That was really interesting, I found, because what would make it work and be of real benefit to these people was to actually dispel that and completely embrace this experience, which I suppose is what a leap of faith is, isn't it?
Well, to be honest, I think applying for this show is one of the first things I've ever done that I didn't know what the end result would be.
Yes.
This is literally a leap of faith, because you apply and you don't know what's going to happen. You don't know if you're going to get picked.
Yeah.
You don't know what they're going to do with you if you get picked.
Yeah.
And it's a whole, you know, few months of don't know, can't plan, can't control. I am, that's why some people see me as a control freak, because I've never done anything without knowing what the end result would be. Conclusion would be.
Right. So this was a new thing.
Yeah.
It was a new thing.
Thought,
so you took a bit of a leap.
Yeah, totally.
Now that I've suggested to Natalie that faith can be a positive thing, all the elements I need are in place for her conversion moment. Now, if I wanted her to continue to believe in God, which I don't, she would need to start looking for evidence in her life to support that belief, and this is vital for maintaining an identity as a believer. When we think something is true, we look for anything which will confirm it to us. We find patterns in randomness.
Okay, let's pause there. In another part of the show, this whole show is 47 minutes long, so I had to cut it down here, otherwise I felt this reaction video might be a little long. I've cut it down to its essence. But in another part of the show, he did an experiment where he demonstrated that if someone believes something, they will often find patterns in randomness to support that belief. When in fact, maybe those patterns were just, you know, fabricated by their own mind. So this is what he's suggesting for Natalie, that if she, in order for her to continue to believe in God, she would have to find some patterns in randomness to continue to support that belief. But I want to point out something subtle here, is that evidence for a belief being true is not simply just patterns and randomness. For example, the evidence for the existence of God goes far beyond just patterns and randomness, as those of you in philosophy might be aware of, for the various arguments for the existence of God, from the origin of the universe, the design that we see in this world, the historical evidence that perhaps God did appear to us in the first century AD in the form of Jesus of Nazareth. And so it goes on, the moral argument for the existence of God. So there are other things out there that constitute evidence. But I think he is an atheist, he stated that, but he seems to believe that the evidence for this belief in God is simply a collection of patterns of randomness that we've accumulated, and that's definitely not true. In fact, in real life, one of the great challenges is to see, is this really evidence, or is it just, did I just sort of put this together in my head as a sort of a random pattern? And that's always a challenge. It's what we do in science. We want to separate the accidental from the legit. So let's continue on here. I just want to point out that not all the evidence, not all the evidence is just patterns and randomness. In fact, I would put very little weight on patterns and randomness.
You've already seen me introduce the idea of a perfect father figure, elicit and combine feelings of awe and being cherished, and allow her to notice a grand plan in her life. I've also attached these feelings to the tapping of my finger so that I can bring them all back in an instant. I'm now going to leave her alone in the church so she can take it all in. And I'm hoping she will piece all of these together and have a powerful and very real experience.
Okay, he's speaking at that crowd he's speaking to. Keep in mind, he already knows the outcome, so he can speak with confidence here that it will be a powerful and real experience for Natalie, because it occurred almost a week ago and he knows what the outcome was.
And what you're about to see now has no music or effects placed over it. Instead, I want you to experience what happened as it happened.
Brilliant. I'm actually just going to nip out for 2 minutes and leave you here for a second. It's actually really, really interesting talking to you, because I do think there are so many beliefs and, I suppose, new experiences, things that are new and surprising that could literally be sort of right in front of us, and we don't even quite register that they're there until one day when we just stand up and then we feel that new thing, which can be really rich and very powerful and right there and really hit us in a very real way. And we can surprise ourselves. Anyway, I'm going to come back in just 1 second.
Okay, I just want to point out how he has set her up, and I'm not speaking out of school here. I'm sure that he expected us to pick this up. But he has suggested that something can be literally right in front of our face, and he physically gestured to an area directly just in front of her and a little up. And he also uses the term, and then one day we stand up and we're surprised. So he's using the power of suggestion here. He's put a lot of things together. He has set it up now so that if she stands up and when she stands up and she moves through this area that he's described just in front of her face, the religious experience that she has been, let's say, I don't know if I want to use the word hypnotized, but it looks a little bit like that to me. That'll be triggered at the moment she stands up and her face moves through that area where he described with his hand. So let's take a look.
You can stretch your legs, you don't need to, you can, you know, get up and move around if you like.
He wants her to stand up, so that's why he says suggests she stretch her legs.
It was important, I felt, to show you that these techniques actually work and that this innate hardwiring we have really can give us a powerful experience of God without any need for him to exist.
Okay, he's going to go back and pick this up with Natalie's experience, so I know you're all interested in looking more closely at this powerful experience you just had. But I want to focus on something that he says here, almost a week later. He says, the ability to have a religious experience is innately hardwired within it. Then he goes on to say, without any need for God to exist. Now that does raise a philosophical problem. The problem is this. Why would we have this hardwiring, this ability to experience God, if in fact there is no God that exists? We have the ability to smell, for example, and it makes sense to us because there are actually things to smell. We have an ability to feel with our fingertips, and that's hardwired within us because there are actually things out there to feel with our fingertips. If we in fact have hardwired within us the ability to experience God, an excellent explanation is that, in fact, there is a God to experience. In other words, that is hardwired within us because there does exist a God. If there were no such thing as a God, we would not expect hardwired within us the ability to experience God, and that's my point here. we can have religious experiences without any need for God to exist, I very much doubt it, in the same way as that we can have experiences stimulated to smell peppermint without any need for peppermint to exist. No. And it goes back to this, it does not logically follow that because we are internally stimulated to experience something, that therefore the actual thing that we think we're experiencing does not exist. No, that does not follow in the least.
Without any need for them to exist. So I've used them to bring about a strong and powerful experience of a religious conversion in an atheist stem cell scientist called Natalie. We're going to meet her in a bit. But first, let's hear her initial reaction to the experience.
Talk to me.
Why couldn't I have had this all my life? I'm saying, I've had moments where I felt complete awe at what I could see, you know. I've been to, you know, music concerts where you leave it and you're just on such a high because the talent you've seen on stage has just blown you away. And oh, it's like the love I get from my family, my friends. I just felt that times a thousand.
Okay, let's just pause here. So what has happened here, and I want to pick up two things she just said. Well, she could be a paid actor, maybe. I'm prepared to give her the benefit of the doubt, and him the benefit of the doubt, that he's not using a paid actor here, that this is a genuine experience that Natalie had. At least, number two is that she was probably hypnotized to believe she was experiencing the presence of God. There's maybe certain powers of suggestion, hypnotic techniques that he used to bring this about. And I think he's pretty much telling us that that's what he's done. He's manipulated her to believe she's having this experience. What I did not expect, however, was the intensity of the experience that she had. I did not expect that at all. I would have expected something like the smell of the peppermint. You know, some people, yeah, I think I can smell that, you know, and other people, no, I can't. I don't know how many people he had to go through this procedure with before he found Natalie, who gave a really good response. I don't know that. As a scientist, I'd be very interested in that, although ethically, I do not feel it's ethically right to meddle with a person's emotions and feelings in such a profound way. But in his defense, he may not have expected it to be this powerful either. This may have surprised him, I don't know. So let's take a look at this profound experience she had. She said, "Why couldn't I have had this all my life?" I noticed, or you may have noticed too, when she was actually having the experience, she put her hands together like this, as if she was praying. I don't think she was praying. It might have just been an instinctive thing, but I thought I heard the word thank you. I don't know who she was thanking, but it seemed real and legit at the time. It was a very powerful, and then she said, talked about all the love she's felt from her friends and her family, and she says this was times a thousand. It was orders of magnitude greater than any kind of love she'd ever experienced before in her life. So what's going on here? Maybe it's just, I have seen at the hypnotist show I went to last at the university, I think it was some university I was at, there were people who reacted, supposedly under hypnotic trance, in quite an extreme way. And so maybe this is just an artifact of reacting in an extreme way. But there's something else that's behind the scenes here, and that is when he did the lemon or the peppermint test, there literally was no peppermint in the room that we're aware of. There literally was none, because it's a physical thing that could be removed from the premises. God is not a physical thing that could be removed from the premises. The presence of God could very well have been there as well. It occurred to me that sometimes you can mess with things that you don't even really fully understand, and you don't know what you're getting into. And I would be a little nervous about what Darren Brown is doing here. He may be venturing into an area where he's quite confident there is no God, and therefore anything you experience is bogus or fake. But that confidence is ill-placed. I there is an enormous amount of evidence that there is a God. So it may be a place he may be messing with things, and what he may have done is create a window that for a few seconds God actually stepped in and says, okay, thank you, Darren. I'm going to really give Natalie an experience of the kind of love that she had no concept ever existed. And then promptly overwhelms her with an unconditional love that's 1,000 times more than anything she's ever experienced before. I don't know if that took place, but I had an experience almost identical to that, except I was alone one spring, on a warm spring day, just sitting enjoying the warm air. It only happened once in my life, and that was the particular time. I was sitting there, and suddenly I became aware of a presence that entered that alcove in the forest where I was just sitting. A presence just moved behind me. It was the presence of God. I knew it instantly. And for a few seconds, I experienced a kind of love that was beyond my capability to handle. Far beyond that. It was overwhelming. It was as she described it. It was like all the love I'd ever experienced times 1,000. And then it was gone. Now, in that case, there were no illusionists or mentalists or hypnotists there to create the situation. I was just there enjoying the sun like I've done 1,000 times before. But I experienced the kind of love now that has changed my life. And so this is the possibility. I'm just throwing it out there, that although Darren Brown does not believe in the existence of God, what he in fact did was open a window for a few seconds through his own manipulation, that window which dropped Natalie's defenses against God, and for a few seconds she experienced the kind of love she'd never dreamed of before. Just a possibility. Let's continue.
When you stood up.
Oh God.
How do you feel when you think about God now compared to how you were earlier on when you came in?
Like a unconditional love that will always be there no matter what. I don't know. Oh, it's so conflicting.
So you think it doesn't quite fit into your scientific...
Yeah. Mindset. Ever the scientist. Oh, God.
Okay. It's what she said here, and what she said, it was like an unconditional love that will always be there. Now note that he never suggested that when he was setting her up for this situation. This is additional information that he has not supplied. And this might be one piece of evidence that in fact what she actually experienced was the real thing. And this is where she got that information from, was direct from God, direct from experiencing the love of God, the full magnitude of it, and that it's so unconditional and so forth. And she also said it was like all the love in the world had been thrown at me. It was completely overwhelming. And this suggests that maybe it might have been a glimpse of the real thing, but of course I don't know. What I will say is that the ability to experience the love of God is obviously wired within us, and the philosophical conclusion is that therefore there must be the love of God out there for us to be able to be wired that way to experience it. It's not a proof, it's just a suggestion.
Here's Natalie, everyone. Thank you for joining us. Now, we've kept you out of the way. You haven't been following anything that we've been talking about here. You don't know what this program has been about.
Excellent.
But they have been following your story, and they've seen what happened to you the other day. I just ask you, what was that moment like when you stood up? Because it was an extraordinary reaction. What can you put into words what that felt like, that moment?
It just felt as though all the love in the world had been thrown at me, and it was completely overwhelming. I couldn't really handle it, because it felt as though that love had always been available to me, but I kind of pushed it away or mistreated it somehow by not letting it into my life.
Now that's interesting. Again, there's additional information there that he did not supply to her at the beginning when he was setting her up psychologically manipulating her to have an experience, a religious experience. And obviously this is almost a week later, and it has had a profound effect on her, still a week later.
Mm-hmm. it's as if my spectrum has just been broadened. You know, it's as if I have this barometer of emotion from really, really bad to really, really good, and that high end has just been extended.
You said to me that day after we'd sort of finished filming, you said this has to be something supernatural, because it wasn't anything felt you could explain.
Technically. Textbook definition is something unexplained is maybe supernatural, but again, because I don't believe in a supernatural, I'm still searching to identify that source.
It must conflicts, some conflicts in your mind. So you're still sort of searching through that by the sound of it.
Still mulling over what happened nearly a week ago, yeah.
Excellent.
I feel...
Okay. Now what he's about to do is he's, again, lapsing into that same tone of voice and kind of power of suggestion here to try and undo what she experienced almost a week ago. So I just wanted you to be aware of that and compare how he's speaking to her in these next minute or so as compared to how he was speaking to her at the table in that church. It's, he's lapsed back into that same situation. So at this point, he's trying to, I guess, manipulate her to believe that there is no supernatural that did not come from God.
I feel duty-bound to make sure that you don't leave this experience with a religious belief that I've sort of just given you. I think the emotions and I think everything you've taken from it is hugely positive. But it's important to me that you can separate the emotions that you felt and everything positive that you've taken from this from a religious belief. So let me explain to you what I did. I elicited feelings from you, emotions from you, but getting you to imagine a perfect father, getting you to imagine a sense of awe. And as I asked you about those things, as you kind of internally found those states, as I asked you what it would feel like, I started tapping on the table. And in the same way that if you listen to a song, me telling you that now, does that devalue it?
It has added a kind of artificial element to it for me now.
Okay.
But again, I suppose inducing an emotional reaction to something, if it's to external influences, it's always artificial in a way.
She still wants to hang on to that. She doesn't want to totally write that off as a completely artificial situation that she was in, or an experience that was completely fake. She wants to hold on to this. And that is why she's saying it in the way she does.
Way, you know, if it's from listening to an amazing piece of music, that's an emotional stimulus that's come from an artificial source, so it's all...
The emotions are real, that's the point. It's just important to me that you don't feel it has to be attached to something supernatural or superstitious, because it wasn't. Okay. And it's not even like it came from me. It certainly didn't come from God, it came from you.
So it's twice there he's just suggested to her that it wasn't supernatural, and it certainly did not come from God. So he's using his power of suggestion, because he's a professional at this, to try and convince her that it was just an emotional reaction and it had nothing to do with God. I think, and maybe he feels this is the ethical thing to do because he doesn't think there is a God, but if in fact there is a God, then what he's just done is very unethical. I think it might be better just to leave the person with their experience, and like we all have to sort out our experiences and to say, is this just my imagination, or is this the real thing? Is this attached to something real?
It came from you, and those are real, perfectly real, real emotions that, as you said, have expanded now your emotional repertoire, and things that you can now carry with you for the rest of your life, but you don't need to attach them to anything superstitious. It's important that I leave you with that knowledge, so you're not being fooled by anything. Right? That's important. But Natalie, thank you very, very much indeed.
Okay, so that concludes the abbreviated form of that video that I am commenting on here. And I guess if I were to, the main takeaway is this, is that just as in the peppermint, inducing people to believe they're smelling peppermint when in fact there was no peppermint in the room, it does not logically follow that therefore there is no peppermint that exists. It does not logically follow that all their experiences of peppermint are bogus. All that follows from that is that very legit experiences can sometimes be simulated with powers of suggestion and so forth. Finally, it is possible that he is messing with things that he is just underqualified to, that he is not very naive about. That is the existence of God, experiencing God. He may have inadvertently created a situation where she did experience the love of God, but it wasn't that God was manipulated to participate in this. I find in my own experience, God is often turns the tables on our best plans and steps in at completely unexpected moments and intervenes in our lives, sometimes in very profound ways. So it's something to think about in your daily life as to trying to separate what is our imagination, because part of his imagination is that there is no God. That's his imagination. There is no God. And that has to be figured out too. He's comfortable, totally assured that there is no God, and blindly forging on ahead, playing with things that he probably has no realization just how big the stakes are and what he's playing with. Well, if you liked the video, give it a thumbs up, and please subscribe to my channel if you haven't already. And also, you can check out my other videos on my channel, and also my website, which is in a link below the video.